Mother's Day. Welcome to Grace Church. We're glad you're here. Let's worship together.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. Forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of a symphony to my ears, like holy water on my skin. Slave to sin, I want to know about being born again. I need you, oh God, I need you. So take me to the riverside, take me under, baptize. I need you, oh God, I need you. Oh, your forgiveness is like sweet. Jesus, you are. for your goodness today, God. God, we thank you that no matter what's going on in the world, that we can look to you and we can look to your word and we can find peace that surpasses all understanding. And Father, as we enter into this next time of worship, as we listen to Pastor Scott speak, God, I pray that you will just speak to our hearts today. And I pray this all in your son's holy and precious name. Amen.
Well, I'd like to welcome everyone who's joining us online as we think of today. And also, I'd like to say happy Mother's Day for all the mothers and grandmothers and those really... this is a great day for you. I'd like you to turn your Bibles with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. You know, last week when I was looking at the message in chapter 2, it talked about the fact that Paul said I was like a nursing mom. And I was thinking last week that maybe I was doing a wrong chapter for today. And actually, as I started this study, I realized that the chapter today is a chapter that really kind of comes off of last week. Paul talked about the fact that he was like a nursing mother, and he was also like a father. He talked about the love that a parent would have for a child. And so today's message is entitled, Overwhelmed by His Love. And I think really today I want to look at that as we think of the Thessalonian church here, as Paul speaks about the love of God and how we really need to see it. And really the difference between Christianity is you have a God of love. You have a God that so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. It's not just about a bunch of rules and regulations. It's about a relationship. It's about establishing a relationship. Not that we achieve that relationship, that we come into a relationship with Christ and then he works in and through us to change us and to transform us. And so as we look at chapter 3, the apostle writes to Thessalonians about what they've gone through and also what he went through. And then he talks about really this theme of love. You're going to see this kind of throughout this chapter. And so in a couple of areas, he touches on it. Because in the midst of love, he's talking about persecution. And you would think, how can you love when you're being persecuted or you're being treated wrong or you're being afflicted and you're being challenged? And yet Paul talks about that here because the truth is, you know what, we're kind of afflicted. And he's even going to say in this chapter that he can't wait to see them. And aren't we like that? We can't wait to see everybody again. When is this thing going to be over? When is it going to be done? So we can actually say hello and express our love and our concern. And so even Paul could not be there and had to send Timothy and had to, you know, you see him all the time. Many times he wanted to come to certain churches and he couldn't do it. He wanted to see them, and he wanted to express his love and to greet them and to rejoice in where they were, and yet he couldn't do it. And so chapter 3, he kind of opens up, and he speaks to this church, because remember the theme here is preparing for his coming. You know, as we prepare for his coming, how do we do that? And so he's going to talk about that here in this chapter, and he's going to talk about preparing by being overwhelmed with his love. I hope you are overwhelmed with his love. Because when the love of God, when you understand what it is, it changes you and transforms you. So beginning in verse 1, he says, therefore, when I could endure it no longer, we thought it be best to be left behind at Athens alone. And we sent Timothy, our brother, and God's fellow worker in the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you as to your faith, so that no man may be disturbed by these afflictions. For you yourselves know that we have been destined for this. For indeed, when we were with you, we kept telling you in advance that we were going to suffer affliction. And so it came to pass, as you know. For this reason, when I could endure it no longer, I also sent to find out about your faith, for fear that the tempter might have tempted you and our labor should be in vain. But now that Timothy has come to us from you and has brought us good news of your faith and love, and that you always think kindly of us, longing to see us just as we also long to see you. For this reason, brethren, in all our distress and affliction, we are comforted about you through your faith. For now we really live, if you stand firm in the Lord. For what thanks can we render to God for you in return, for the joy with which we rejoice before our God on your account? As we night and day keep praying most earnestly that we may see your face and may complete what is lacking in your faith. Now may the God and Father himself and Jesus our Lord, direct our way to you. And may the Lord cause you to increase and abound in love for one another and for all men, just as we also do for you, so that you may be established, he may be established in your hearts, unblameable in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ with his saints. Let's pray. Father, today I pray that you would help us to understand how important this whole topic of love is. Lord, there's something within this chapter that we see that there's a tremendous love that Paul has for the Thessalonians and they have for him. And he encourages them to keep learning to love. And Lord, we know that the love of God is what brought your son here, the love you have for us. And Lord, that love is the proof we know from your word that it says, by this shall all men know that we're your disciples if we have love one for another. And so we know, Lord, that love is powerful. And so today we come before you and we ask you, Lord, to speak to us, to encourage us, to help us, to continue to reach out and to love people. Help us to realize the importance of expressing and sharing love. And I ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as we look at this chapter, once again, we see the importance of love. In chapter 2, verse 7, now Paul says, I was like a nursing mother to you. There's nothing greater than a mother's love. I mean, many times you think about a mother and you think about her children, and don't get between a mother and a child. You know, you hear that little phrase, mama bear? That's like in nature, that if you actually have a female bear and you come between her and her cubs, you are in serious trouble. And we understand that there's such an intense love of mothers for their children. And so we see that in the scripture. It goes on to say in 1 John chapter 4 that the one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. You know, it says more than once that God is love in the book of 1 John. And so as we think about God being love and we think about the power of love and we think about what he's doing here, it's very interesting that it says, and he that does not love does not know God. It doesn't mean that if you and I aren't expressing love, that obviously we don't know him. But I think many times when we don't choose not to express love or we find difficulty in expressing love, maybe it's we don't know him the way we need to know him. Maybe we don't become and that's why I've entitled this overwhelmed by his love. Because if his love becomes so real to you and so real to me, then it's going to affect the way we treat other people. And so I want you to become overwhelmed. I want the love of Christ to become something that's so powerful that it's life-changing. You know, one of the things we see in this scripture when we see John, the disciple, and it's interesting that Jesus, and it says this four times in the Gospel of John, it says that the disciple whom Jesus loved. Isn't that interesting? My thought is, did Jesus not love the other ones? Or was it that John knew something they didn't know? I think they had a very special relationship because you remember when they had the Lord's Supper, he leaned on Jesus' breast and he said, who betrays you? He's just kind of there. That's how John was. But I think there's something else to this. I think John got it. I think John got it in a very powerful way that he understood something about love that others didn't understand. And what's amazing about John is, guess what? He writes 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John in the book of Revelation. And in 1st John, chapter 3, it's about love. Chapter 4, it's about love. And one of the proofs of your salvation is you love people and you love God. If you don't love people, maybe you don't know God. And John just once again comes at the end of his life. And he's still pushing that theme of love. He's still saying how powerful love is. And what I believe is that John got it. He understood it. And love is something that we understand. When we understand God's love for us, maybe we wouldn't condemn ourselves so much. Maybe if we'd realize that he came while we were enemies, that Christ died for us, while we were sinners. If we understand that when it comes to the love of God, that if we could somehow capture that, maybe it would change me and I'd stop trying to do it another way. I'd get to this place where I'd understand the power of love. And so I want to look at what love looks like. I want to kind of walk through this chapter. I want to kind of touch on love. And by the way, these are true of anyone who wants to love, and especially mothers today, right? Yeah, I mean, you're gonna love. I think one of the most incredible loves that you could ever see is the love of a mother. And so the first thing we see here is that love gives. Who gives more than a mother? And who gives more than God? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. As a matter of fact, it says in the book of James that every good gift comes down from the Father of lights. And there's no shifting of shadow. In other words, God doesn't change. He's just a good God. And see, he's good and he's love, and that's who he is. And so what we understand is that love is something love gives, but also that when we think of giving, think of sacrifice. I want you to notice in verse 1, it says, "And when we could no longer endure it, we thought it best to be left behind at Athens alone." And then he goes on to say, "And we sent Timothy, our brother, our fellow worker, into the gospel of Christ to strengthen and encourage you in your faith." And so what Paul did is he thought of sacrifice. You know, he could have used Timothy. You know, when you love someone and you sacrifice, you do without for their benefit. When you love someone, you send your son out of heaven to become a man in order to save us. There's something about sacrifice that's so powerful. And there's a little book in the Bible that we don't think a lot about. It's the book of Philemon. It's one chapter. And Philemon got saved under Paul's ministry. And you know what? Paul sent him back to his master because he felt like that was the right thing to do. But he says, "I send him to you, but really, I could really use him. But I didn't want to presume upon you. So I sent him to you. And I want you to know that he's valuable to me, but I sent him to you anyway." You see, Paul understood that love is very powerful. And he says, "And maybe I sent him back for you. And maybe he came to me. Maybe this all happened so that not only could you have him as a slave now, but you could have him forever as a brother." You see, it's really interesting to see what God does and how what we see here is that Paul understood sacrifice. And he understood, and he sent it. You know, he sent his very best. You know, God sent his very best. He sent his only, one and only son. And translations say begotten son. In other words, it didn't originate anywhere. God caused it. And God caused Jesus. You see, Jesus was born of a virgin. It's amazing. The Holy Spirit came upon Mary. I mean, think about the very best. In verse 2, it says, "And we sent Timothy, our brother, our fellow worker in the gospel to strengthen and encourage you as to your faith." I'm sure Paul could have used them. If you go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, he says, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly. Again, you see, Paul is talking about the Philippians, and he says, "I want to send Timothy to you also, that I may be encouraged when I learn of your condition, for I have no one else of kindred spirit who will genuinely be concerned for your welfare. You know his proven worth, that he served me in the furtherance of the gospel, like a child serves his father." He says, "I'm sending you my very best." And then he also sent Epaphroditus to them. And Paul's always, you know, he had this sense, and I could use all these people, but you need them. And that's what's interesting about giving love. And also, giving is not easy. You know, when you give, it's not always easy. It's usually not convenient. But it's something we have to learn to do. We got to learn that kind of a giving love is not easy. And by the way, it's not always appreciated and valued. I could talk to every mother. You know, your kids don't get up in the morning and go, "Oh, Mom, God bless you. I'm so glad you're my child. I appreciate everything you sacrificed to me. Oh, Dad, I appreciate everything you give to me," right? Did they do that? But you give anyway. You give because it's the right thing. You give because it's what's needed. It's not easy, but it's what's needed. In verse 4, he says, "For indeed, when we were with you, we kept telling you in advance that you were going to suffer affliction, and so it came to pass, as you know." You see, he said, "Look, you got to realize something. I'm going through it like you're going through it, but I'm still sending them. I'm still going to do what's right. It's not always easy. Matter of fact, those who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus, what? Will suffer persecution." But what does he tell Timothy on the front of that? You see, I gave you verse 13 of, verse 12 rather, of 2 Timothy 3. But verse 10 says, "But follow my teaching, my conduct, the purpose of faith, patience, love, perseverance, persecution, suffering, as such has happened to me." He says, I want you to know that you gotta just keep doing the right thing. It's not going to be easy because these things are going to come. Is it easy to raise children? Do you ever have your heart broken? You see, what we've got to understand is, even as a pastor, is my heart ever broken? As a parent, is your heart ever broken? As a friend, as a people you work with, is your heart ever broken? It's not easy. But if you're really concerned for the souls of men and women, if you're concerned about your children, you're going to realize that you need to do what needs to be done. In verse 5, he says, "For this reason, when I could endure it no longer, I also sent to find out about your faith, for I fear that the tempter may have tempted you and our labor should be in vain." You know, even Paul saying, it's tough, but I still care so much about you because I have a giving love. I understand what is needed. And he says, I want to tell you the tempter. Matter of fact, it says in 2 Corinthians, he writes to the Corinthians, he says, "But I am afraid lest the serpent, as he deceived Eve by his craftiness, that your mind should be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ." You see, he said, I want you to understand that. I'm concerned for you. But then remember this in your concern. Isaiah 41:10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will hold you with my righteous right hand." And Jesus said, don't fear those who can kill the body. You don't fear those can just kill the physical. He says, fear those who can cast the body and soul in hell. What are you saying? He's saying, I want you to know that God knows the hairs of your head, they're numbered. That he cares for you. He cares for the sparrows. He cares for everything around you. Do not be anxious, saying, what shall I eat? What shall I drink? What shall I put on? For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. There's that sense in where he says, I want you to know that your Father gives. Matter of fact, he says he causes the sun to rise on the righteous and the unrighteous. Isn't that amazing that God is, he's a giving God? He gives to people that don't even appreciate it. You ever give to somebody you didn't appreciate it? Sometimes it's hard. It's hard sometimes to give and to give and to give, but that's what love is. Matter of fact, it says of Jesus that he came until his own, but his own did not receive him. Wow. That's huge, but he still came. He knew everything. He knew he was going to be rejected as a whole, but he came anyway so that he could reach the world. And so love gives. Another thing we learn from this chapter is it unifies. You know what? Isn't harmony so important in the home? Isn't unity so important in the church? Isn't unity important in the business? How about the country? You think we got a little problem with unity? Understand the importance of love is the thing that will break down the barriers. Let me say it this way. You know what how powerful love is? It's the super glue of faith. See, it's something about love that can pull things together. In verse 6, it says, "Now Timothy has come to you and has brought us good news of your faith and love, that you always think kindly of us, longing to see us just as we also long to see you." There's something happening here. You know, that one chapter in 1 Corinthians on love, he says, look, if I could speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but I do not have love, he says, it's nothing. It's a noisy instrument. It's a clanging cymbal. It's a gong. It's whatever translation you want to use. It's just a bunch of noise. But he goes on to say that love is patient and love is kind. Love does not envy, does not boast, is not proud, is not rude, is not self-seeking, is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in truth. It always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, it always perseveres. Love never fails. He says the prophecies are going to come, they're going to be done away with. All kinds of things are going to happen. He said, but when it comes to love, he says, I'll tell you, there are things that are important. You have to have faith, and you have to have hope, and you need love, but I want to tell you the greatest of those three is love. Because love changes things. Love changes people. And so love is the super glue of faith. It has a way of holding it together. It has a way of pulling it together. And love also, when it's supplied, has a way of giving the person you're loving confidence about who they are. It helps them find their identity beyond themselves. It helps them see who God is, because when you love like God loves, they understand who they are. Notice what he says in verse 7. He says, "For this reason, brethren, in all our distress and affliction, we were comforted about you through your faith." And then I love verse 8. You see, we don't sometimes read things the right way. Look at verse 8. Look at what it says. "For now we really live if you stand firm in the faith." You see, what happens is when your love impacts and people then rise up, I'm really living now. You want to know what living, you want to live, you want your life to matter, you want your life to be the best it could be? I'll tell you what, love people and watch what happens. That's the greatest gift you can give, is to love people, because when you love people, when you reach out in love, that affirms people. And then now let's look at the verse again. Look at verse 8 again. He says, for he looks at their faith, he looks at the effect of his influence on them, and then he says, for now we really live. Man, I really live, man. I live because my love has changed you. And he says, if you stand firm, he says, oh, I hope what I do impacts your faith. And he's connecting it there. And he says, because I live because of what it's doing to you. 1 John chapter 4 says, God is love, and whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence in the day of judgment. Do you realize love can change a person's confidence? You love people and you affirm people. Wow. You love your kids. Wow. What starts to happen is that love has the power to change everything. Why did Jesus say, by this shall all men know you're my disciples? Because love is powerful. It's the love of Christ that draws us to himself. We understand that love is powerful, and that's what we see here in this passage. It unifies. It also says, you see, you know what love also says? It says, I'm second. You know, I've seen a video, some maybe you've seen on YouTube, it just goes, I am second. How many of you have seen that? You know, that video of I am second. And it always talks about the importance of putting others ahead of you. You know, we see that in Philippians. We see that in the scriptures. He says, notice what Paul says in verse 9. He says, "We give for what thanks can we render to God for you in return for all the joy with which we rejoice before God on your account? As night and day, we keep praying most earnestly that we may see your face and may complete what is lacking in your faith." You know, Paul says, man, my whole life is about seeing you rise, putting others first. Philippians says, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, let each of you regard one another as more important than himself. Do not merely look out for your own interest, but what? The interest of others. Paul's saying you want to know how to express love, and when you put people first, when you say, I am second, when you become a servant, what did Jesus say? He said, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many. But what was that on the heels? You see, that was the last verse of the passage where if you want to be first, be a servant of all. Some translations said you want to be first, be a slave. How do you like that one? How many want to be a slave? See, that is what God is talking about. It's going to take that to unify. It's going to take that to change people. And so we got to learn the importance of saying, you know what? I got to think outside myself. When I was in Bible college, the president of our Bible college wrote a book called The Danger of Self-Love. Do you know that's a problem? do you know it's not hard to love yourself? Did you know that? It's not hard to put yourself before other people. But yet Jesus says, if you won't come after me, deny yourself. Take up your cross, follow me. Daily. There's that power of putting yourself second. You know, putting God first, putting others ahead of you. You know, I guess you could say third then, I guess, because God has to be first. So even other people, it's just, there's so much power, and that unifies. You know, when you become unselfish, it makes such a difference. You know, as I was going through this, I realized, you know, I don't know about you. I have a problem with selfishness sometimes. And it's important for us to understand that we have to keep working on love and what it is. The third thing about love that I see here in this passage, this is awesome. It transforms people, changes them. For the love of Christ transforms you. Did you know that? Hey, you know what Paul said? The love of Christ, listen to this. The word used in the King James, for the love of Christ constraineth me. In other words, what he's saying, the love of Christ controls me. It changes me. It has a way of kind of guiding and directing my life. And that's what he's talking about here. And what's really powerful about this passage, look at verse 11. This is amazing, verse 11. Because you know what I love is God's personally involved. I was reading this and I said, this is awesome. He's intimately involved in your life. He's committed to you. Look at verse 11. Now may our God and Father, I love this word, himself. He could have said, may our God and Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. But he didn't say it. He said, may our God and Father himself. It's kind of interesting that it's kind of thrown in there. In other words, he's saying, I want you to know that God is personally involved. And then he comes along and he says, and Jesus, our Lord, direct our way to you. He's saying, I want you to know he's involved too. I want you to know that God the Father himself is involved, and I want you to know that Jesus is out there navigating your life. You need direction? Need hope? Jesus is the navigator. He navigated his way to heaven, from heaven to earth. Guess what? He knows how to navigate around earth too. When he walked on the earth, he knew exactly where he was going. Matter of fact, he said, my time is not yet. When they wanted to make him king, he left. When they wanted to kill him, he says, not yet. It's not time. I want you to know he's in charge. And what we see is his personal involvement. In Ephesians chapter 2, it says, but God, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, when we were dead in our transgressions, he made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved, and he seated us in heavenly places in Christ. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that none of yourself. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. In other words, he says, I stay involved. I don't just get involved. I'm always involved. It's never going to change. I'm going to be involved in your life. He says, hey, I'm the vine. You're the branches. Everyone who abides in me bears fruit. He says, I want to stay involved. I want you to stay plugged in. I want you to be part of my life. I want you to keep drawing strength from me. Really interesting here is John chapter 16, when it talks about the Holy Spirit coming. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteous judgment. In other words, he says, I'm even going to work in your conscience. I'm going to work in your mind. I'm going to work in your heart. And then he goes on a few verses later in verse 13. He says, and I will guide you into all truth. He says, I want you to know I'm going to stay involved. I'm going to be involved on the outside, the inside, whatever side you want to be. I'm going to be involved in everything. I'm going to be guiding you in everything that has to be guided. And I will disclose to you what is to come. But we see this transforming love here. Not only is this personal involvement, I'm going to tell you, when you really get a hold of this, it's going to change it because it's captivating. It should be captivating. I talked about overwhelmed by his love. I want you to be captivated. When I start to understand what God did in order for me to have my eyes open, to see him, to come to know him, and all he did on the cross and all he has for me, you know what? It doesn't get dull. It doesn't get old. I'm still learning. It never gets old. I hope that captivates you. Now notice what it says in verse 12, and may the Lord cause you to increase and to abound in love for one another and for, I like this, all men. Well, you don't know the person that I have to sometimes love. Yeah, all men. Just as we also do for you. So God's saying, hey, we can love the people that love us, and we can love the people that may be hard to love. See, what God's doing here is God is saying, I want you to know that my love can cause you to increase and abound. He says, I want you to know that my love can grow. You can love people that right now you don't feel very loving towards. You could have a marriage where you're struggling, and you know what God says? I can bring that love back. You could have a child that is really stretching you, and God says, I can teach you how to love them in their way. And by the way, you know your children don't all need to be loved the same way. I mean, they all need to be loved by you, but there's different ways to reach different children. They have different interests. They have different desires. They have different abilities. They have different focus. And I don't know, as a parent, I'm always trying to figure out the differences. And it's important. We've got to learn. We've got to grow in the knowledge of what needs to be done. Romans chapter 5 says, we know how dearly God loves us, and we feel this warm love everywhere within us because God has given us his Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. That's the Living Bible. Other translations said, for the love of God has been shed abroad within your heart through the Holy Spirit that he's given to you. So how much love do you need? He gave you a reservoir called the Holy Spirit. It's untapped. You can't drain it. You can't exhaust it. He can give you the capability. But what's interesting in that passage in Romans 5, he said this. He said, when we were utterly helpless, with no way of escape, Christ came just at the right time and died for us sinners who had no use for him. I mean, you talk about love. We didn't want him, and yet he came anyway. We didn't know we need him, yet he came anyway. And even if we were good and really wouldn't expect anyone to die for us, even a really good person, rather, but it says, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And it said, since by his blood he did all this for us, how much more will he do for us that has declared us not guilty? Now he who saved us from all this, all of God's wrath and anger to come, and since when we were enemies, we were brought back to God by the death of his son, what blessings he must have for us now that we are friends and he is living within us. Think about that. Wow. That is, God is a God. And even Paul said to the Ephesians, he said, look, I bow my knee before the Father. He says, from whom every family in heaven and earth derives its name. He said that you may be filled with the power through the Spirit to the inner man so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith and that you being rooted and grounded in love. I want to tell you, you can't exhaust the love of God. And he wants to pour that love into you and me. But we got to change our focus. I want you to notice in verse 13 that he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with his saints. There's coming a day when he's going to return. He's going to return with the saints. Go read Revelation 19. It's pretty awesome. He steps out of heaven and the armies of God follow him. It's amazing when you start to actually think of what is coming. But we got to change our focus. And one of the things we need to remember, we can study prophecy. We can always think about the second coming. I don't think that's the purpose for writing about the second coming. The second coming is that we are prepared now, so when he comes, everything we've been doing on earth has eternal value. I guess I could say it this way. Remember that heaven is my destination, but it's not my mission. Heaven's not your mission. Your mission is here. I'm going to heaven. I said yes to Jesus, I'm going. But I want to tell you that my mission is to share the love and the grace of God and of Christ. It says in Titus chapter 2, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires, to live sensibly, righteously, godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. That the second coming should motivate us to live out the life God's called us to live. Not to think about heaven itself, but to think about the mission we have so others can be in heaven itself. Understanding what God is doing in our lives. It's interesting that when John writes in John chapter 3, 1 John chapter 3, he says this, beloved, now we are children of God, it has not yet appeared what we shall be. For we will be like him because we shall see him as he is. Okay, so that's the truth. He's going to come. We're going to see him as he is. But it doesn't stop there. He says, everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. You see, the second coming is about us being ready to meet him, knowing that we will hear these words, and I hope all of us hear it. Well done, good and faithful servant. And that's really what this is about. Matter of fact, from 2 Peter, it says this, they're talking about the end of the world and the destruction of the world. He says, since these things ought to be destroyed in this way, what sort of people ought we to live in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God? That's always kind of an interesting verse that I need to be challenged, knowing the end is coming, knowing that he's coming. I need to be a person that I have holy conduct and godliness. And then it says, looking for and hastening the day. Wait, what do you mean hastening? It almost sounds like we have something to do with the second coming. Boy, I read this, that somehow what we do and people being reached, and maybe it's the fact that when that last person it says yes, then all of a sudden Jesus comes, whatever that is, I don't know. I don't know what it is. I'm looking at it here with you. But somehow our lives are a message. Our lives make a difference. So that's what we see here as we look at the passage. So I guess I want to ask you today is, does God's overwhelming love overwhelm you? See, love is so powerful. It can break down barriers. It can reach people. And that's what Paul was talking about here. Let me just read you a passage in closing as we think of this topic of God's love. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, it says, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God, and everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not know God, whoever does not love, does not know God, because God is love. Maybe because if you did, you would know and be love," right? Maybe what he's saying is that those who really know him, and I think we can all read this and go, "Well, I don't love the way I should," right? Not as much as I should. So the truth is, if my lack of loving sometimes, I don't think he's really trying to write, say, if you don't really have a real love, that somehow you don't know God. I think sometimes the truth is we don't really know God the way we need to know God. I think when I really start to get overwhelmed with what his love is, and this is how God showed us, showed love among us, he says this, "He sent his one and only son into the world that we might live through him." Oh, wait a minute. He sent his son that we could live out what he's done? Yeah. Oh, he didn't send his son to die on a cross? Well, he did that. He didn't send his son so we go to heaven? Yes, he did that. But that's not your purpose on this earth. He sent his son so that you could what? That we might live through him. In other words, what it's saying is that the purpose of his son is, yes, being born again, yes, being a child of God, yes, knowing you're going to heaven, yes, all those things. But the truth is, while you're here, that he might live through you, that you might be the love of God to a lost and dying world, that you might be a love of God to the people you work with, that you might be a love of God to your family, that you might be that love, and that's what it says. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. And so God calls us to love. And what Paul was talking to the Thessalonians, he says, I'm going to tell you, as it says here in that verse 21, he's coming. Be ready. He is coming. But I want you to know that while you're waiting for him to come, I want you to work on love. I want you to be more of what God wants you to be. He says, when you become that person, then guess what? You're going to impact lives and you're going to be more ready for his coming and you're going to help others become ready for his coming. And this is what God's message is for us for love. And Jesus said, I give you a new commandment that you love one another as I've loved you. He said, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples if you have love one for another. He's saying, you know what? When you love people, especially those that are not easy to love, when you love people and you have no motive in loving, see, the world loves to get. But when we love the right way, we love to give, not to get. We love to unify. We love to see people's lives change. We love because we believe what God said. And so when you and I do that, it makes all the difference. And God's called us to be love. Love to a world that needs a salvation through his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so today, as we look at love, I want to ask you today, will you ask God to help you love more? And today, if you've never trusted Jesus Christ, I want you to know, like, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And then verse 17 of John 3 says, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him should be saved. And so today you can trust Christ into your heart and life as your Savior to say, God, I know that Jesus came and died for my sins, and I trust him as my Lord and Savior. And you ask him to come into your life, to be your Lord and Savior. And that's where the love begins, because then he says, for the love of God has been poured into your heart through the Holy Spirit that he's given to you. And Jesus said, unless you're born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. He said, look, when you trust him, The Spirit of God seals you, makes you a child, but you have to trust Christ. And so that's the way to first be acquainted with God's love, knowing he loved you so much that even when you were enemies, Christ died for you. Will you trust him? Will you ask him into your heart and life? Will you say to God right now, "Dear God, I know that Jesus died on that cross for my sins, and I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I trust you. I surrender my life to you. I follow you." In Christ's name. As believers today, will you choose to love? Understanding the power of love, the power of giving, the power of unity, the power of transformed lives. Remember that when you love people, you're helping them change. Let's close in prayer. Father, today, help us all, God, to be those who are an expression of your love to a world that needs to know you. Help us, God, to trust you, to look to you, to rely on you. And Father, I need you to help me to love more. I don't always do it. I fall short. Help me to be a better husband, to love Veronica more. Help me, Lord, to love others more. Lord, you said the love of God has been poured into our heart through the Holy Spirit. So God, there's a resource that we can't exhaust. Help us to remember that as we surrender once again to be a loving expression of your love so that people would see in us Christ in us, the hope of glory. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And today we're also celebrating the Lord's Supper. I know we did contact everybody with that. And so what I'd like to do here is we're going to take the Lord's Supper. And then after that, I'm going to actually share a little bit about one of our missionaries, as we've talked about that. And then I have one other thing. And then the worship team will come back up and we'll sing our closing song, which is called Be Still. And so let me just share this with you. And so we learned from the scriptures that the Apostle Paul writing said this, "I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took also the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Isn't that amazing? We're doing the Lord's Supper, and this is what we do until he comes. See, everything we do is about him coming. He's going to come. So will we be ready, and will we see how many others can be ready when he comes? That is what it's about. The second coming is a nice event. We can do charts, and we can try to figure it out. But ultimately, you know what it's about? What we're going to celebrate right now, that his body was broken, that his blood was shed, so people can find forgiveness, restoration, cleansing, and can have a relationship with God. So the first thing I want you to do, and those of you at home, I know we told you we'd be doing it. So what happened here is that the Bible says that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he's betrayed, it said that he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So if you have the Lord's Supper, the bread at this point, you take that. It also says, in the same way he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." He says, "Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so if you have a cup at this point, and so what we have here is we've taken that Lord's Supper. Let me just pray. Father, thank you. We now thank you for the cleansing. We thank you for the fact that, God, you sent your Son to take our place. And so, God, today we just now celebrate what you've done for us that we might reach people. And so, Lord, today I come before you, and I thank you, Lord, that we can keep proclaiming you until you come so that others would be ready to meet you. And I thank you for all this. In Jesus' name, amen. What I'd like to do is talk about the missionaries we have today. And we're going to talk about two Awana missionaries, and we've got them on the screen behind us, and that is Bob and Dorinda Bennett. And so they've been Awana missionaries for over 20 years. And so what's really interesting is, and I didn't realize this when I saw their letter, when you think about it, guess how many churches they oversee? 130. You talk about being busy. You talk about responsibility. And so we have the privilege. And what I want to do is I want to read a letter from him. It's just a short paragraph. He says this about the pandemic. This is what they're learning. Wow, what a unique time to be doing ministry. God has given us an opportunity to reach out to kids and families in ways we never have before. Now that clubs are not able to host big meetings, we have been busier than ever, helping churches adapt to online format. Many Awana leaders have found small ways, online, by phone, by mail, to connect with children and families, to encourage them to share the love of Christ. The bottom line is that the children's ministry is all about making disciples, and discipleship happens through relationships. As we have an opportunity to help people see this, many have taken off from there and have developed their own way of connecting and building those relationships. And so this sounds exciting. And then also some prayer requests. Here's the request. Pray for the effectiveness of every Awana club. Number two, pray for the health and energy of the Bennetts and those involved, because it takes a lot of energy. Pray for the vision to reach children and families, and they will, and that they remain strong. And then the last request is pray for a special online meeting event this coming Tuesday, May 12th, and Awana is hosting a meeting, and it's going to be about making the greatest generation of disciples ever. So those of you that are involved in Awana, you probably got the email. It's something you can join the Bennetts, and they're going to be doing this with all the clubs. And so what we want to do is we definitely want to pray for them as a missionary family. And so let me just pray right now for the Bennetts. Father, we thank you for them. We thank you, Lord, for their heart for kids and for discipleship and reaching the children, Lord, that are in the clubs. I thank you, Lord, for the work they're doing. I thank you, Lord, because we see it. We see them involved. And I don't know how they do 130 clubs, but God, we know, Lord, they are worthy of our support. And so we thank you for the privilege of supporting them. And we thank you, Lord, that we can have them as a part of what we're doing. I pray you bless our children here at this church, Lord, and those that are involved. I know there's so much going on with online school and some doing Awana. It's just it's a big task, Lord. So we pray, Lord, that you would just bless those families for the rest of this time. If we don't get together, that in the September we'd start off strong and solid. And so I want to thank you for that, Father. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, at this time, the worship team is going to come up, and they're going to be singing a song called Be Still. And so this song really, it says, "Be still, may peace be in my heart. I know you're my Lord, my God. Stay strong through all the stormy days. You're by my side. You calm the raging waves. I will worship you, for I am not afraid. Your hand will lead me through the darkest nights. I will worship you. My hope is found. My life is marked with love for all my days." Isn't that interesting? And the second chorus also talks about, "My life is marked with love for all my days." I find that's interesting, that as we close with this song, you can only be still if you know God loves you. And so let's close with this song as we talk about being still. He said, God said, "Be still and know that I am God."
Reaching waves. Peace. May peace be in my heart. I know that you're my Lord, my God. Stay strong through all the stormy days. You're by my side. You come to reaching waves. John 16:33. Jesus said, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have troubles, but take heart, I have overcome the world.
Father, we just come before you today. We thank you, Lord, that we can be here together as a church family. And Father, we do pray that you would just bless and guide everyone that's here. And so we thank you, Lord, for those that are here, those that are watching. Oh God, may you show your love to them. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, before you go, let me just say a couple of words. We are looking to reopen Grace Church, but we're trying to determine. So a lot of the country is already doing it. They're trying, they're beginning, but once again, New York is different. We're a little bit behind because we have a lot more cases and a lot more infection, and we're not at the same place. And so there are stages that are the government and the different places within the country are allowing public gatherings to begin. And so we will be notifying you as we progress. So hopefully soon we'll be able to actually send you out some notices and let you know what's actually happening. So continue to pray as we meet as leadership and we try to determine, because like everyone, I am looking forward to getting together again. I miss you all. May God bless you. Love you guys. Anyway, God bless. Have a great day and a great week. And once again, ladies, happy Mother's Day.